We got memory. We see now that you could recall some things, but you forgot other things relatively quickly. But when you saw it for that second, if I had asked you the next second what was the word that was just up, you would have had no problem remembering it, especially if it was within 2 or 3 seconds. So where did it go when it was gone? Well, we know you didn't move it into long-term memory, didn't come out of short-term working memory. But for all those that could write those things down after we've elapsed that short-term memory window, you did have it in a long-term memory. My guess is it's not going to be a very long-term memory. And then if I asked you to write down those words in, say, 3 months or 3 years, you wouldn't be able to write many of them down at all. So where did it go? We don't know. It does seem that you haven't fired that set of circuits that much. You certainly haven't done it repeatedly. And so those circuits don't consolidate. And it just seems that it decays. It just is another way of saying it's not permanent. It goes away. Varying lengths of time for different people, depending on the stimuli, but memory quality or quantity wanes with time. Again, you may have some memories that are very potent that you remember for a whole lifetime, but there won't be a ton of those relative to all the experiences you had in your entire life. It may seem like a lot. Some people can tell stories for ages, but those are just some stories. I'm going to show you an example in a minute of ineffective encoding. Some people think that they forgot, but they never really knew to begin with. Remember, we said that this all assumes that you perceived it. It assumes that you moved it from sensory memory to short-term memory, and it assumes that you moved it from short-term memory to long-term memory. And some people are like, I don't know why I can't remember that. I was in lecture. I don't get it. Or I was just talking to that person the other day, and I can't remember what they said. Well, it may not be that you actually forgot it. It could be pseudo-forgetting. You never really encoded it. Not having encoded it, you couldn't be expected to remember it. Interference theory says that you forget due to competition from other information within your memory, that you get a memory formed that's new, and there's other already existing information, and sometimes there's so much overlap or there's similarities or you've got nodes that activate one another that you get confused. And sometimes you got the other way around. You got old information where you get new information and it interferes with being remembered in the other direction. Those directions you'll want to remember before you test. They're retroactive and proactive, and I'll put up an example here. Since y'all came today, if you know the difference between retroactive interference and proactive interference, and nothing interferes with your recall of that information on the test, you will do well on that item that exists. As best I remember it being on the test. It's a little bit tricky, so you might want a mnemonic. Why is it tricky? The people who get it right, oftentimes, they don't pick the other two that are clearly wrong. If these two are there, what do? They flip-flop them, which, you know what it does? It just is an example of memory issues. They knew the type of answer that it's supposed to be, but they couldn't pick out that fine level of detail. Retroactive, what happens when people are dressing retro? Right? Something from past, right? So new interfere with old. Going back. Now I'm dressing retro, which is a hearkening back to the old. That's one way. What's proactivity mean? It means getting on to something, right? So in this case, something from the old is going to get on to something new. Old interferes with the recall of the new. And this interferes with learning this interference stuff. So you know what? We'll just start right here on Monday, and I'll see you all then. Y'all have a wonderful weekend. Be safe and have fun. Again, being here the other day, I said, you know, you might really want to notice proactive and retroactive interference and be able to distinguish between the two. Come up with a mnemonic that will help you to remember the difference between the two. Retroactive, now going back, right? And proactive, old coming forward. So the example given, there's some material that overlaps between biology and psychology. So if you had studied for a biology test and then you study for a psychology test, and then you take this psychology test, and you start thinking about the biology information because you can't get that out of your mind, this is coming forward to interfere. The old coming forward to interfere with the newer information would be proactive. The reverse was true. You study for the psychology test first, and then you study for the biology test, and you start taking your psychology test and you're remembering biology information because it's interfering. Well, the newer information is interfering with the older information. It's a technical distinction, but one worth making and certainly one worth knowing for your test. The idea is that information acquired at one time interferes with information acquired at another time. And I'd pointed out up there that a lot of people think they've forgotten something that they've actually never inputted to begin with. They just assume that they're going to remember something, but they didn't encode it. And so they didn't really forget it because they never really knew it. Never got out of sensory memory, never got out of short-term memory, didn't get into long-term memory. Or if it did, it decayed rapidly. As we saw with the forgetting curve, information that's new and novel decays rather quickly and extensively. So I got a test for you to see about how well you encode information. If you'll draw on your paper before you, just the basic outline of what the front of the Pal's restaurant looks like. Try to encode, don't talk, because then you're conferring with other people's memories. Just see what elements of the front of Pal's you can remember. Because you probably, if you're from here, see it every day or certainly many times throughout your lifetime. It's such a distraction to me that I didn't even realize East Tennessee State University was across the street from it until I came to interview. All those years I come, I just stare at that building. So odd, so unique. Never seen anything like it in Charlotte. And there it was, staring me in the face. Kept my attention, but how much do I really remember of it? What's on the front of that building? What color is that building? Is there anything else around that building? See what you got. You got the gist of it? Everybody good? All right. The Pal's memory test. Just made it. That's the front of a Pal's. It's the front of every Pal's, I think. I may be wrong about that, but the first thing to get is the French fries. How many people got the French fries? All right. Second thing to notice is the shake or the cup. How many people got the cup? Next thing is that gigantic weenie. How many people got the hot dog? Next thing is that gigantic hamburger. How many people got the hamburger? Then you got that gigantic flag. How many people got the flag? Didn't even think about that being part of it. And how many people got everything? A couple people got everything. So if you think about it, having seen this building over and over and over again, but you don't remember all the pieces on it, that's normal. Why? Because you didn't study it. If you had studied it for a test and repeatedly inputted that information with the intention of moving it from short-term to long-term memory, elaborating on it, et cetera, you'd be more likely to remember it. The same thing happens with a penny. I won't do that example, but if I had you draw a penny, most people don't get all the elements on the head of a penny exactly right. They know what a penny looks like, generally speaking, but only people who are coin collectors actually study the face of a penny. So the date, the words, the face, the direction the face is pointing, et cetera, there's a bunch of elements that you wouldn't really pay attention to unless you were paying attention to them.